Okay, I think we're going to get started. Thanks for all of you for joining this last session of Red Hat Summit 2016. My name is Mark Coggan, and we've assembled a really great panel of customers of Red Hat to talk to you all about, you know, their kind of use of container technology. And our goal is to really take the great learnings of the companies and these individuals here, these customers of ours, and impart them to all of you who are hopefully also curious, either, you know, early stage or maybe middle or later stage of your own journey towards the use of container technology. But we hope and expect that you're going to learn and come away from today's session with some great insights from these practitioners. So my name is Mark Coggan. I'm responsible for solutions marketing at Red Hat. We're going to take a little bit of an introduction. I'll give you an introduction of our guests here. And then we're going to just start a dialogue, very interactive dialogue on stage. And I'm also going to be asking all of you to provide some questions for the panel members. So start thinking about what you want to ask. We're not going to do it at the end. We're going to sort of just, you know, do questions throughout. And if you have a burning question that happens to fall right around what, you know, something that you hear one of the panel members talking about, you know, throw up your hand, and, you know, if it's timely, we'll ask you to share that question. We'll have a microphone going around the audience. But we'll also be asking, again, questions throughout, and hopefully you'll walk away with some learnings for your own work with containers. So let me take a moment to introduce our panelists in no particular order. Mike White from Cisco, Chris Collins from Duke University, Rukevbe Esi from FedBid, and Marcus Soares, who is representing UOLHost, but today is now an employee of Microsoft, very recently joining Microsoft, bringing Linux expertise to Microsoft. That's something we're all happy to see. So what I'm going to ask, I'm going to go through, and I'll probably attenuate these slides, but I'm going to ask each of the panel members to take, you know, about a minute and a half, 2 minutes, to introduce themselves in a little bit more detail than I just did, including your role, maybe your company, and just give a thumbnail of your current sort of state of IT infrastructure. Not so much about the containers, because we're going to come, that'll be the next question I'll be asking you to elaborate on. So just kind of a thumbnail on, you know, today's technology and infrastructure. So Rukevbe, if we could start with you, please.
I work for FedBid Inc. We're a software company based in Vienna, Virginia. We are a fully managed marketplace with the unique characteristic of being a reverse auction or having a reverse auction engine. And it's sort of an interesting way to describe the services that we offer, and it sparks dialogue as well with people who's, what is reverse auction? It's essentially the reverse or opposite of a forward auction, which is eBay, something like eBay, where sellers or suppliers come compete to win a deal. So they're dropping their prices. We're primarily in the B2B, B2G space. I am SVP of technology, so I'm responsible for all the technology for the company. From an architectural standpoint, we have a classic, you know, layered architecture. Front end built with JavaScript frameworks, middleware, you know, running on Oracle technology, database tier running on Oracle, MySQL, and several open source platforms, and then all this running on RHEL, and we're recently, actually, as of October last year, we 100% migrated all our applications and systems from our own co-located data center into AWS.
And that's going to be an important point that we're going to ask you to drill into, and how containerization helped you make that migration into the public cloud. So thank you for that introduction, Rukevbe. Marcus.
I'm going to describe my previous job, not my current Microsoft job. So I used to work for a company called UOLHost. It's a large Brazilian conglomerate with several different companies within media business, data center, hosting, cloud business. I was on the hosting business, which is more known, like GoDaddy, King Host, this kind of business where you have retail for hosting, for end users that have absolutely no idea what IT is, and they need to have a very affordable solution to provide their websites or their WordPress, their blogging, whatever, let's say, a simple or complex solution to them. And on that scenario, you have a retail business, so it's thousands and thousands of consumers using the technology. The challenge that we had was we must provide different versions and of, for instance, PHP. You need to have a full stack of PHP from 5.2 to 7, different versions of MySQL, Java, or whatever open source technology that you name, you need to provide. And on top of that, we need to make sure that we isolate the resources so you don't have this noise neighbors problem. So,
and don't get into the
I'm not going to the solution. So, those were the challenges that we had, and we're going to discuss a little bit during this session.
Thank you, Marcus. Mike, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. Am I on here?
Yeah.
Okay, good. I work at Cisco Systems, a networking company you may have heard of. But I work in the Global Infrastructure Services Organization, so the part of IT that provides infrastructure services, compute, networking, storage, platforms, databases, and messaging middleware. My role there in particular is around platform as a service for web applications. So I've been doing that for close to 16 years now. And our goal, maybe similar to yours, Marcus, is that we're trying to run all of the IT applications on as little infrastructure as possible. And again, the noisy neighbor problem, isolation is important to us. And so I guess that's what I do.
Great. Thank you, Mike. Chris? And Chris is an alumni panel member. Chris, for those of you who came to Red Hat Summit last year in Boston, we had a similar panel discussion on containers. And Chris was kind enough to share some early learnings then, and he's going to extend the kind of update the story today for us. But just give the basic introduction first, Chris.
Chris Collins. I'm a senior automation engineer at Duke University. I work for the central IT department. So we generally deal with the infrastructure needs of the university, as well as focusing on research and education and how we can help students and faculty members move with their technical challenges as well. Our environment is, as you can imagine, extremely varied in terms of what it is that we're running. But for the most part, it's all RHEL servers running Puppet to manage those and starting to move into the container space as well. So.
Thank you, Chris. What I love about this panel that we've assembled is they've all come to, you know, use containers from very different points of view, starting points, and just kind of their stories in the technology are all very different, and it's going to be very great for you. Before we get started and go into a little bit more depth, I'd just like to take a poll from the audience, because I think that'll help frame the conversation with our panel. How many of you would consider yourselves just sort of learning and evaluating the technology at this stage? Hands, please. Containers, yes. How many of you would consider yourself sort of doing pilot or early proof of concept type work with containers? And how many of you would say you're in production with some container technology? Okay. Sort of what we'd expect. But the good news is a lot of you are here, are kind of very, you know, early stage trying to learn. So this is perfect forum for that to be accomplished. So what I'd like to start with is, you know, in any particular order, is give a sort of a thumbnail of what you're doing today with container technologies. And when Chris, when we come to you, perhaps you could tie back to the story last year you shared around the denial of service attack that you mitigated and how that kind of brought you in as well. But kind of what's your state of the technology today?
Sure. Well, I think our situation at FedBid is actually a little different from the rest of the panel, and probably more so in line with most of the hands that went up, where in the evaluation stage, early prototyping stage. And as I mentioned earlier, we migrated from our own co-located data center to AWS in October of last year. Now, as any of you knows, in the AWS environment, the more instances you use, the higher your costs basis are. So I'm very focused on, or I was very focused on, cost and managing our expenses on the platform. And that's actually how the conversation around Docker came about. The first 2-3 months, on AWS, we sort of, saw our costs sort of tracking up with the utilization of the services. And then we started projecting out towards, the rest of 2016 and what that looks like in terms of the number of instances we would have in our environment, and what the costs could look like, going forward. Now, I'll preface this by saying, the move to the cloud was significant. We essentially reduced our operational expenses by almost 40%, which is great in itself, but if it starts creeping back up to match the exact same cost of the previous year, that's not very attractive. Secondly, we are, I'm challenged with, the same challenges that most senior leaders are sort of challenged with regards to talent retention. So it's important to keep the team engaged with new technologies, with exciting and innovative technologies, as well as making a difference with our product. In addition to that, we're also tasked with adding value to the business. So we don't want to take on innovative, implementations or innovative technologies if it's going to cost a lot and not necessarily add value to the business. So those are the different things that we sort of, have to juggle with in order to make a decision from a technology standpoint. Now, containers just plays very nicely into, the value proposition from a business standpoint, because the way that we looked at it is if we could reduce our footprint and increase the utilization of the EC2 instances in AWS, we could actually deploy as many containers on the EC2 instances that we have and manage our costs from that standpoint. It also solved issues of the near neighbor concerns with upgrading applications with dependencies, interdependencies across different components and different applications. And all of that reducing cost and allowing us to be more innovative and keeping my developers happy. So we sort of solve all of those problems in one.
Mike, why don't you go next?
Yeah, I'll take a
little
crack
different
at where
different angle on the story, but what's your use of container technology today at Cisco?
I think the end result isn't all that different, but the way we got there might be different and interesting. So we started maybe 4 years ago working with Red Hat trying to offer an open source PaaS platform. So up until that point, we had been offering a Java web app platform and a Perl platform, and those had been running for 10 or 12 years. And our developers, much like yours, were wanting to develop using the latest and greatest open source languages, and we didn't have a platform for doing that. So we got involved with Red Hat, deployed the OpenShift 2.0 platform, and that was our first introduction to containers. So we've currently got almost 1,000 applications running on OpenShift 2.0. They're deployed across 3 different data centers, and we support all the application life cycles from dev to stage, test, production, and DR. So I think we've got 40 or 50,000 containers running in OpenShift 2.0. What we're working on currently now is bringing in OpenShift 3.0 with the Docker and Kubernetes backend and looking to offer more than just a PaaS platform, really exposing those APIs to the developers so that they can bring their own containers and technologies and deploy them on our infrastructure.
Great. Thanks, Mike. And like you, when you started with OpenShift 2, you were using different technology constructs like Gears and Linux containers, LXC, C groups that gave the same, you know, kind of benefits of containerization, but weren't sort of at the current state of the art with Docker and Kubernetes. But they, but yeah, hold that thought. We'll go into it a little bit more. But I think that the tie is to Marcus, who also started fairly early in a similar vein.
Yeah, we started that 4 years ago, approximately, and with the problems that I just mentioned in here. And back then, it was a harder field to work with containers because today we have a lot of new technologies, orchestration mechanisms, and you know monitoring everything has been kind of addressed some way or the other. So all the big players are looking at that. And when we started that with Linux container LXC 4 years ago, we had to do all things manually. You had to create your own config files. You had to do everything. To generate an image was really hard, which nowadays is, you can use a public GitHub, a Docker Hub image. You can use a certified image from Red Hat or for other vendors. So it's today, if you're thinking about containers, the life, it's really easy. For us, the you know what really drove us back then and is still a really valid argument is we as developers, we always want to upgrade our software. I don't like the idea of being hostage for a single version or for a single particular version of the kernel or of the application. So we are seeing more and more security issues, Venom, Heartbleed, all kind of stuff you are seeing. And you might have a hard time upgrading that if you are into a monolithic schema. So containers help you with that. So it's really easy to upgrade and move forward your infrastructure. The other way my colleagues highlighted here is the ability to save resources. Some of the workloads are really good to overcommit resources. For instance, PHP, Nginx, Apache. You can overcommit memory easily. It's really, really save you a lot of money with AWS. So you can put a lot of dozens of containers on 8-gig machines, depending on the workload, of course. But it's really easy to save you on the resource. And for as a developer, if you're a developer, we love to have the ability to spun a new container, run a test cases. Drop that container, so it really brings the agility to your environment. So that is, it's really important.
So thanks, Marcus. And as Chris gets ready for his remarks, I'm going to ask Kimberly Craven, my colleague, to take the microphone and start thinking about questions that you're going to want to ask the panel members. So if you have a question, raise your hand, and Chris will sort of introduce his current state of the technology and what they're doing, including, again, giving the story from last year. And then we'll take a question.
So we came to embrace containers as a result of crisis, really. About 2.5 years ago, I'd heard about Docker containers, and I was starting to look at it. And I'd only really played around with it for like 2 or 3 weeks. I started talking to some colleagues about, hey, this thing might be really cool. When our main website, duke.edu, became a target of a somewhat unsophisticated denial of service attack. And we were able to sort of handle the problem a little bit by routing all the traffic for that for the source of the attack to dev null or whatever. But the load that it was putting on the load balancers was affecting the rest of the services that we had internally load balanced. So at some point, everybody was just kind of standing around trying to figure out what exactly we were going to do to deal with this. And I kind of came up to the group and was like, okay, well, I've been playing around with this Docker thing. It seems like it's really cool. We could probably move the main website into Docker containers and push that out to AWS EC2 instances and see if we could route the traffic for the denial of service out that way and let Amazon deal with that. So that it, right? So, and yeah, we paid him for it. And so we were sort of out of ideas, and everybody's like, okay, that's great, go ahead and try it. And my CIO gave me his credit card, and I walked back to my desk, and because we'd not done anything with Amazon either at this point. And it took me about 25 minutes to really build a basic lamp stack in a container to run the main website. And then signed up for the AWS account, and most of that time was actually doing the billing part, and pushed out a bunch of EC2 instances running our website and load balanced it with a Elastic Load Balancer, and then went back to the group and was like, well, so I got this thing ready to try out, and they kind of looked at me in shock, just like that was like 25 minutes ago. So we gave it a shot, and the denial of service attack followed DNS right out to Amazon. And everything quieted down internally. We actually left it out there for several months. All the external traffic to our main website was going through Amazon in these containers. And that was a really great, really quick win that bought a lot of trust in the platform and in the technology. At that point, I was the web hosting technical lead, and I pretty much stopped doing any web hosting and focused entirely on containers and talked about containers nonstop, and that moved up to where we are now, where we're doing a lot of infrastructure with caching DNS servers. We've got Kerberos KDCs and Shibboleth SPs and containers. We've got on-demand web hosting for Drupal and WordPress sites. Our main website is in it. Large-scale WordPress enterprise web hosting is in containers. And we're doing research stuff for faculty members. Shiny servers for graduate students who are doing economics and want to have an easy way to publish their results in an interactive fashion. And it's really just everything we're doing now is starting to go into containers first if possible. And even the things that are existing, the monolithic services that we had, we're starting to tease out the things that could become microservices from those and move those into containers as well. So it's been a huge win for us, huge.
So what did Amazon or AWS think when you and Scott McCarty presented this at the AWS reInvent conference, talking about how you used them as the decoy for the denial of service traffic?
Nobody said anything, and I imagine in the background they were just like, yeah, money, we're good.
Okay. All right, well, let's take a question from the audience right here, please.
Hey, my question is for Rukevbe. So I have, actually, it's a two-part question. One was, you mentioned a 40% savings in moving to Amazon, and I'm kind of just curious where that savings was, if you're able to talk about that. And secondly, if you're able to say whether your apps were containerized before you moved to Amazon or if they became containerized in Amazon. Thank you.
So I'll start with the second question first. They were not containerized at our data center. And right now we're working on containerizing them. So we have proof of concepts in the works on one of the major components that we just rolled out a couple of months ago. On the first question, we reduced our costs from a few areas. One, obviously, building your own data center, you're procuring hardware that you're not necessarily using, right? So, and you're subject to the refresh cycles that, with the rapid change in hardware infrastructure. And then secondly, from a managed services standpoint, so we had a host of companies that we were working with, basically monitoring our systems and maintaining our platforms. And when we moved to AWS, we essentially slashed a lot of that. We are, for the most part, a cyclical business, if you will. So a lot of our work actually, or a lot of the volume through our marketplace happens in the latter part of the year, in the end of the fiscal year, government fiscal year, because they're probably about 85-90% of the volume through our marketplace. So being at AWS, we're able to actually scale. So we build the minimal infrastructure required to support the level of traffic, for the low periods of the year. And then we make changes to the EPS volumes, the size of the instances with regards to memory, to scale up as we need to, in the latter part of the year where we get a lot more volume.
Great question. Thanks for sharing that. And again, please, others who are thinking of some questions, start queuing up and raise your hand. We'll get the microphone over to you. Maybe next question I'll ask Mike is, talk about sort of, you know, the internally, were there barriers that you kind of saw either technologically that you had to overcome, or maybe culturally within the, you know, within Cisco that you had to kind of break through to get sort of moving around this technology?
There definitely were both technological and cultural barriers to adopting containers at Cisco. The technology challenges are probably the easier ones to solve. So an example, our base operating system from the compute team was RHEL 6. When we wanted to start using containers, we needed RHEL 7. So we had to work through with the right teams to get a RHEL 7 image that we could run Docker containers on. But those are the easy things to solve. The more difficult challenges are really adapting to this paradigm shift, the more dynamic nature of applications, containers coming and going. How do you monitor those, right? How do you monitor that app? How do you secure it? How do you apply network policy between these containers that keep moving around, right? So these are some of the types of challenges that all of our old processes and systems had to be rethought or adjusted in order to support the new paradigm. Continuous delivery and integration. You're no longer taking a WAR file and putting it into a running app server. You're ripping a container out, throwing it away, and starting up a new one. So all of these processes have to be thought through as you start shifting to containers. But I think the end result will be a much more agile, dynamic data center when we get it all figured out.
Marcus, you want to add to that?
I'd like to add something that happened. And if you're going to this path, make sure that you bring the network and security guys to the conversation on the very first meetings. I had like a headache to, you know, have my new VLANs, but the VLANs for the host and VLANs for the containers, we separated on different VLANs. So it was like 3 months to make sure that the network guys accepted that. And security guys, they are going to give you, you know, headaches as well, because, you know, it's different. It's not the way we used to do. I want you to do that way. So we had a lot of discussions on this week about security on containers. So they are secure. They probably are more secure than what you already have right there. So if you apply, if you do the right way, they are secure. But of course, if you're going to run as root, open and out, you know, ports, of course, that's not secure. But that's not a container problem. That's your architecture problem. So
they can be made secure.
Can be made secure.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Another question we've got here.
My question is for Chris. So are you guys using OpenShift, or did you do like a roll your own with Kubernetes and Docker? And a little follow-up is what are you doing for persistent storage, NFS or Gluster into the containers? If you could speak to that. Thanks.
So we're not using OpenShift at the moment, or we're not actually using Kubernetes at the moment, although we're working toward trying to do that. Part of what we're doing is we are using RHEL Atomic Hosts, but we're using the Docker remote API and managing that directly with a web service that we've been writing. A lot of what we do is actually letting untechnical, unprivileged people create their own services on demand. So that requires a kind of a layer of abstraction away from the ability to actually run Docker commands or manage, you know, clusters and that kind of thing. So that's where kind of the web service helps us. We really want to tie the web service into Kubernetes directly. And after this week, I'm going to be spending more time looking at OpenShift as well. In terms of the persistent storage, we've done a couple of different things. Mostly what we're settling on now is either volumes mounted from the host into the containers, and or NFS mounts that are on the host mounted into the containers as well. it really depends on the service. As a university, we don't have a ton of really large scale services that are load balanced and across multiple hosts. So it makes more sense for, you know, the smaller websites to have their own kind of host with their own local persistent storage as opposed to like a large scale network share or Gluster. I think Gluster or Ceph has a lot of promise, but that's a little more overhead than we need at the moment. So.
That will go to another question, and then we'll come up here after that. Yeah.
Thank you. What advice can you give on the transition your people had to go through from a supporting of this? My company, we were a very traditional VMware running Red Hat and in different versions of that, and you know, very monolithic systems. You know, obviously we get developers, but how does the load shift from supporting that? Obviously, if they can spin up systems, but you know, the DevOps moves some of that to the developers. How did you handle that transition as you're moving from old to new?
So before we answer, who was running on VMware infrastructure first to start? Before.
Before.
Yeah. So all of you guys. Okay. So fire away. Whoever wants to take the first crack at that, let's do it.
So a couple of years ago, at Cisco, we really caught on to the DevOps kind of model. But, you know, what we're finding is that there are pockets within IT where some groups are resistant to change and where other groups are eager to innovate. So what we're doing, this is kind of an adoption story, how to get started, is we're starting with new applications, greenfield, where these innovative groups will take advantage of the new technology, will accept the responsibility for some of their availability or their own upgrades and patching, and they then are used as kind of shining stars that others can aspire to. And that seems to be a model that works pretty well. Then we come in after you know, putting these folks up on a pedestal, if you will, and we augment with tooling and automation so that some of the more traditional applications can be migrated or transferred without having to get into all of the nitty-gritty and use the API directly. So we want to do both, actually.
Anyone else want to add to Mike's comments? I mean, I'm going to do a quick audience poll here. Those of you who are doing sort of that early stage experimentation with containers, how many of you are doing it on bare metal hosts? Show of hands, please. And how many of you are doing it on virtual infrastructure, be it VMware or Red Hat's virtualization? Okay, a little bit more. Yeah, that's what we see with some of the other inquiries and polling we do with our customers. Lots of folks who are starting to deploy, you know, this onto existing virtual infrastructure. So. But you want to add to the question about VMware?
Actually, so to the original question that was posed regarding cost reduction, just wanted to throw one more thing. The biggest cost savings we actually got was eliminating licenses. So we got rid of a lot of products, started using AWS services and other products that were actually cloud-enabled. So that was probably the biggest savings that we got. With regards to, you know, adoption within the enterprise, I think it's really important to start small, and I think greenfield is really the best way to go, which is how we're going about it. So eventually I would love to, you know, port the entire architecture, but we're starting with the latest module that we just built, which is essentially very decoupled from the existing architecture, and we're essentially gonna containerize that, and hopefully we see the success that we want. The developers, the idea is get the developers more involved in the deployment process from a non-production standpoint. We still need to figure out what the process looks like with regards to, you know, going to production, but ultimately we can do more with our sysadmins and, you know, with regards to the load that we get with all the application deployments that we have.
Take a question right here.
Good afternoon. Some of you already addressed this to a degree. We have some rather new instances of Docker that we've put into production, and we also have a lot of Docker that's also in our integration set of servers. but and we have much more coming on the way. My question is, what best, and I know you've already addressed this to a degree, what best practices would you recommend to those who need to use containers in a larger scale?
Anyone who wants to jump in and take that? Containers at scale, kind of the summary of the question.
Yeah, well, there are a few steps that we learned on the hard way. The first thing, now you have a composer, an orchestration mechanism, so you need to use one of those. The next thing I think is important, make sure that you are using layers on your images. Let's say, for instance, that you have like a WordPress running on PHP with Apache, not Nginx, with Apache. So have a layer for the core operation system. Make sure that that layer is secure. Stripe out everything that you don't need. Since you control, if you control the application, you know what which binaries and libraries you can remove, so that makes that container even more secure.
Reduce the attack surface, basically.
Yeah, remove. Yeah. So if your PHP, if your PHP got hacked, and the offender is going to look for a sudo, there will be no sudo on your base image, and this kind of stuff. You need to remove everything that you don't need. Make sure that you have the PHP core, and then you have the layer. Each layer, create a layer for each service that you have, and stack those layers so you can upgrade easily, you can grow easily, so that will help you to move forward with your scaling that image. And also, it will allow you to run on the same host. You can overcommit the resources if you want to. Some workloads, like databases, you can run databases on containers. As well, we did that, and it works fairly well. But those you cannot overcommit memory on sensitive things like databases. Memory is, it's really sensitive. The buffers helps database on performance. So make sure that you understand what's going on. And have one or more guys of your team to understand what's going on behind the scenes. If a container go down, or if something is froze or something, you need to understand what's going on. So have a KDAMP enabled, have a kernel debug if you need to. Well, today is easier, the life is easier, because everything is more stable. But you need to have someone, understanding the behind the scenes. Docker run and Docker really makes life easier. But when you're going to scale in the production, you need to have someone in your team that understands what's going on behind the scenes. So,
anyone else want to add to that question of performance at scale before we?
So in some ways, the scaling is similar to the challenge of scaling anything. I think your point about using an orchestrator to manage your cluster is important. I mentioned kind of the scale we've reached so far with containers in production. That tended to scale pretty linearly. As we consumed nodes, we added more. Applications got deployed pretty smoothly across the infrastructure. And so we've been able to scale up to a certain size just by leveraging the capability of the orchestrators and the cluster managers. The other thing that I think is still emerging and you're starting to see is the tooling to help you monitor and measure what's going on in your cluster. Since you've now got the ability to move things around, knowing when you're approaching certain limits of resources and then being able to rebalance your workloads, I think really helps you get to that scale. Maximize what the resources that you have, know when to add more, and rebalance.
We see another question, Kimberly, over here, so please. We'll figure out who to direct it to once you ask.
Well, this question's really for all of them. They represent a pretty good cross-section of different business type sizes, et cetera. My question is, did any of you face the decision of OpenStack versus containers at any point? And do they coexist in the environment, or did you choose one over the other? And what led to that decision?
We've had at Cisco discussed that as well. And we're running both. I think at this point in the life cycle of containers, there's a place for both VMs and containers, and even containers in VMs. So we're running both side by side. They're both exposed through an automation layer that we call Cities at Cisco. It's kind of the front door service catalog, and you can order virtual machine instances out of OpenStack, and you can order container applications from the container platform. You can order the PaaS stuff. You can order your database. So we're running both side by side.
Anyone else want to comment on OpenStack and containers? I'll add the session that preceded this one in the room here was a container stack for OpenStack. And so Red Hat sees these two, as Mike said, as being very complementary. They serve different needs, different purposes, but they also fit together very nicely. And we're working very hard in the upstream communities through projects like COLA and Magnum, and also looking at how do you containerize the OpenStack services and then even deploy and orchestrate them with Kubernetes. So there's a nice marriage and complementary nature to them. And as you've probably read a lot, our point of view is that VMs and containers are very complementary as kind of technologies to abstract and isolate workloads. And we don't see, despite the pundits and the press, we don't see VMs dying and being killed off because Docker and containers are going to, you know, take over the world. We see these as fitting nicely depending on the workload.
And for those of you who missed the session before this one, it was recorded and it will be made available to attendees so that you can watch it on demand later.
Yeah. Another question.
Yes. I want to give a little bit of context to better understand the situation. We are moving from a very monolithic application to a more like a microservice application architecture, where we're now seeing that it's being deployed very traditionally. Each web application, or a Tomcat instance web application, is being deployed per VM. So that makes our infrastructure growing very rapidly and our infra utilization being very poorly used. The networking aspect is for us, at least I find it a little bit struggling. How would I containerize all the Tomcat web application instances, which are customer-facing APIs and needing container-to-container network communication? So I'm struggling with that in my mind. How do I containerize all the separate web applications and enabling them to be reached as we're putting more containers per host? So I'm not sure for who's this question, but maybe...
Sounds like a little bit of what you dealt with, Rukevbe, but Chris as well. I mean, whoever would like to start.
So I think my answer would be probably more conceptual than anything. We haven't seen any negative performance impacts on the prototype applications that we're actually looking at working on. But it's essentially just that. We have a product or a web application, and we've created a Docker image for that application with Tomcat, the libraries required for that application, running in the container. Now, obviously, the sort of client applications are not containerized yet. But there's the concept of a cluster with the different instances of that Docker app. So from our experience, we haven't had a problem, and we don't really see any negative impacts with that. Could you have a problem if there's a lot of intercommunication? Possibly. But I really don't have any statistics around that. Based on our experience, there's really not been an issue.
Chris, do you want to add any comments or thoughts?
We haven't done a whole lot with like container-to-container networking between hosts. But for link containers, the networking between those works really well. There's not really an issue. In terms of dealing with, I don't know if you're talking about having multiple instances of the same types of applications on the same host so that you have like port issues, but we were discussing that earlier this morning as well. We at the moment we're using something called Docker Gen that was written by Jerome and from Docker that does watches the Docker socket for the containers that are running on the host, and we'll configure a router using templates whenever a new container starts up. So that allows us to put a whole bunch of different web services on the same host that are all expecting, you know, port 80 and port 43 to themselves. So they're not actually, you know, opening any of those ports up. It's all being handled by the load balancer on the host. And my understanding is that in like OpenShift, the routing layer does that really well also, at least from the people I've been talking to.
I see two points on your question. Is the first thing is the how you design microservices. So this is one thing. And of course, when we start to break down your application and create dozens of microservices, every time that you split, there will be a hop in the network. So if you had like one big monolithic service, it was one hop. And now if you have like 10 microservices, they are, you know, chained, there will be, you know, several chains. So your hop will increase. So that is a design of the microservices. It's, I guess it's not really related to the container. The other thing that you mentioned and which I suffered is, okay, the Java container, when you're going to start the Java, the JVM, you need to set up your heap sizes. And the new HTTP handlers, they use NETI, which does not use the heap memory. It uses OS memory, which can lead you to out of memory on your container. So if we can go deep on the details, so if after, because it's...
Yeah, maybe it's an afterward
topic. Yeah, because it's getting too much Java and, you know, Java and container stuff. But yes, you need to have a balance how small your microservices is going to be to Mike, avoid those hops.
Mike, did you want to add or some things too?
Yeah, I think we've... if I understood your question properly, I think Chris is right. When you start using an orchestrator like Kubernetes and or OpenShift, they take care of a lot of the service discovery between your individual components and enable that networking connectivity without exposing those to the neighbor, right? So within Kubernetes namespaces or OpenShift projects, the communication between containers is disallowed, but within the project, you can establish those linkages. That happens quite nicely with the service discovery and routing. There's another challenge, though, when you start running a multi-tenant platform, in that when you want to talk to existing dependencies outside of the container platform, how can you do network access control between individual sets of containers and, say, an external database? And that's a problem that hasn't yet been solved, but we're, being a network company, actually looking into that. We have an open source project called Contiv, C-O-N-T-I-V, that is a bridge between container orchestrators and a programmable network so that you can program some of these dependencies and apply network access control between containers and external dependencies.
And I think one of your colleagues presented here, maybe not this in this session, but I'm sure somewhere, on Contiv. So I'm going to throw a more general question out to whomever would like to take it. So knowing now what you know about the technology, the limits, et cetera, what would you do differently if you were kind of starting over a year or 2 years ago? What would you do differently? Who wants to start with that? A little bit open-ended. You can also abstain.
Well, since we started with Linux containers, today I would use Docker instead Linux containers. Of course, Docker is just the layer. It's not the virtualization, the lightweight virtualization mechanism. So I spoke before, use layers, use Docker, and make sure that you have an orchestration mechanism. Back then, when we started, there were no orchestration mechanisms, so we had to do all in hands. But nowadays, you can choose several good options, so it's easier. And put everyone on the table early on the project. It will save you a lot of time to get the approvals. For a big company, it's hard to get all the approvals for a new network, for storage, and for security. So that what I would do differently.
Looks like everyone wants to contribute with some thoughts. Go, great, that's great.
I was just going to quickly reiterate what Mark has said. I should have taken his advice in getting the compute, network, and storage and guys, and security all on board earlier. That would have smoothed the path. And then finding maybe that one killer app like you kind of stumbled upon that really proves the value of containers to make that point.
When we got started with it, a lot of the orchestration tools either they were still in development or they were pretty young, and it was more difficult for us to try to use those than it was to try to work on something that would meet our needs directly. If I could do it over now, I would have picked an orchestration tool early and kind of stuck with it and use our own custom stuff to talk to that instead. Trying to tease that out and trying to just re-implement the management of containers at a large scale is extremely difficult, and I'd rather somebody else with way more engineers do that than our small team, right? And I also, as much as humanly possible, pick a good demo and talk to everybody, because in any given group of like 50 people, you can give a great demo, and at first only like one or two of them are going to have that light bulb moment where they're like, oh, that looks really cool, let me get involved in that. So trying to get more people on board has been kind of a struggle, and it's like a snowball. It's picking up speed as it goes, but it was pretty slow going when it's just, you know, one or two people working on something, until you can get over that cliff or whatever, so where it starts to take on a life of its own.
Okay.
For me, it's not so much what we would have done differently, because I think We've taken the right steps. We've had a very measured approach. I wish we had containerized all our applications before the AWS migration. I think it would have made that whole process a lot easier less painful. Even though I think we did a pretty good job with that migration in the time that we did, but. I believe, you know, if we had that, then the migration would have been much easier than it turned out to be.
All right, great. Time for one more question. We got a couple here.
Those of you on public cloud, did you evaluate using OpenShift dedicated instead of kind of also managing it yourself? Or did you find some reason to need the control or a cost difference with using a more than managed service of OpenShift?
So for us, we didn't really evaluate OpenShift, and I would probably say for the most part was cost-driven. Eventually, it's probably something that we would look into, but that was, cost was the primary driver behind the move to AWS, and since we didn't really need it, we didn't explore leveraging it, the first go around.
Let's just get this last question in here quickly, and then we'll go to kind of the wrap-up comments. I think we have time for, as long as it's short.
My question is did you experience any scenario where you have to add containers on the fly to support customer traffic? And if so, we do have a multi-tenant framework in that scenario. Like, if I need to add containers in multiple layers, what are the challenges that you face? And if you need to restart them in the multiple layers, what are the challenges that you faced?
Who's tackled that issue?
Well, one of the features that was present in OpenShift 2 that is still present in 3 is the auto-scaling function. So all of our applications have minimum and maximum thresholds set on how many instances ought to run. And so that's something that we've never overscaled. So the applications are bouncing between their min and max in order to adjust to load, but we've never had all of the apps all scale at the same time where we needed to add infrastructure to support that. So it's actually worked pretty well in our case, I'd say.
Anyone else want to add before we go to final remarks? Chris?
We've done a little bit of the auto-scaling within AWS as well, and it's really, if you set up the rules correctly, well, it it grows quickly, especially with the ability to make an image of the operating system with the image of your container in it. So it just like comes up and starts and gets put into the pool. That works extremely fast and extremely well. And then with the right rules, it'll recover itself and scale back down without having too much human intervention. So it's worth investigating. Yeah.
So last kind of question, and we'll just go down the line here. Knowing the audience, knowing sort of where they are in their stage of evaluation, and you touched on this a moment ago, but what's sort of the final 2-3 points you want to leave the audience with as they embark on their exploration and journey with containers, that from your learnings, pitfalls, benefits, et cetera, what would you kind of want them to walk away remembering?
I would say it's hugely beneficial. It's going to change the way that we're doing everything. So if you're not doing it already, dive in and start taking a look at it. Talk to people who have done it and kind of get their takes, and talk to, when you are doing it yourself, talk to people that you work with that might be skeptical, and just continue to show them the benefits. And everybody will have that moment where they realize that it makes sense and it's worth working on.
And I think in our case, speaking of the benefits of containers, it's important to look at it from multiple sides of the coin. There are benefits on the infrastructure side around density and cost reduction, and there are benefits to your application team as well. The application teams are wanting to deploy new technologies. They're wanting to do continuous integration and delivery, so they're asking for it. And the infrastructure guys are asking to reduce the cost and not buy new hardware. So if you can, I think we've got a technology here where you can finally marry infrastructure and developers' interests towards a common goal in technology. So look at it from both sides of the coin.
Remember many years ago when people discussed virtualization? Remember that times? No one's talk about that today. So I see, and we saw container, that as an application virtualization, it's the same concept applied to your application. It's the ability to deploy anywhere, anytime, quick, fast. That's what server virtualization brought us and changed it, the landscape of, data center, cloud business. We see containers on the same path, but on the application side, we didn't have anything on the application until recently. Containers brought that to the table. And many companies are using containers to allow them to build and create a multi-cloud strategy. Containers run seamlessly between clouds, either Amazon, Azure, whatever cloud you want. Containers will help you to move. If you had done, as you spoke here, the containers before moving, it will be easier for you to go to any cloud, which would make the price, the one we have better price, better performance, you could change instantly, right? So containers bring that to the table in addition to what my colleague said.
I think the rest of the panel has really touched on most everything. I think the last piece that I would sort of encourage everyone to think about with regards to this is more from a leadership perspective. It's about thinking about the business value and trying to sell that. We all love new technology, the cutting edge stuff, but if it doesn't provide value to the business, it's always a tough sell. So finding the business value and selling that is probably the most important piece that I would sort of emphasize.
Yeah. So that's great, great. Set of comments and final thoughts, folks. I would just summarize to say, the container journey starts from many different points, technologically or otherwise. I think the benefits we see here are just very multifaceted, from kind of infrastructure efficiency, portability of applications, driving better utilization of the infrastructure, serving and melding together the needs of applications teams and the infrastructure teams, the isolation of dependencies into a container, so you gives you much better efficiency across infrastructure hosts and much more flexibility. So the multifaceted set of benefits. But having said all this, I want to kind of thank the panel members, Chris, Mike, Marcus, Rukevbe. Thank you very much for your time. Your insights, and I want to thank all of you for coming to Red Hat Summit 2016. Hopefully you're all staying for the remainder of tonight's event party. We're excited to start that at 7 o'clock, I think, in Moscone North will be the party. And you know, we really appreciate and love these interactions we have and hope that it was very, very fruitful for you as well. So we'll see you soon and maybe next year and talk to us off, you know, tonight and outside the room here. Thank you.